Michael, would you apply the Geneva Conventions if one of the people who committed a horrible act against us was in fact a state official? Would you apply the Geneva Conventions there or not, or do whatever it takes?
Christopher is correct. I would not apply the Geneva Connection there either. One of the individuals from the Mumbai attack, one of the terrorists, survived and is in custody. And if that individual was believed to have actionable intelligence about a future attack, any means necessary to exact the information from him, I would support. Listen, the Indians apparently use truth serum, and I don't hear anybody beefing. I've read all about it in the UK press. They've detailed it. Nobody's beefing about the means that have been used in India about this.
Let me try to apply this again. What
if it was a blowtorch?
What about the Japanese soldiers, the generals or whatever, the officer corps who were convicted of war crimes for using waterboarding against some of the flyers who were part of the Doolittle raid over the 30 seconds over Tokyo heroes? I mean, from their point of view, they were operating in self-defense. Would you say that they were operating morally by waterboarding one of our flyers? I'm just asking you, tit for tat here, from their point of view, the Japanese point of view. I don't defend the Japanese empire in one instance, but where do you draw the line morally on what's in and what's out? Or does it just depend whether you're American or not? Is that it? If you're American, anything goes?
Chris, I'm all about defending American interests.
In other words, your moral system is based on, if you're an American, anything goes. If you're in the other country, we try you for war crimes, you lose the war, we cut your head off, or whatever it takes, we execute you. In other words, your morality is entirely nationally based. I'm just asking.
I'm going to answer if you'll give me the chance. My moral code is dictated by the fact that I want our leaders to be guided to protect American lives.
Okay, so
first.
A Japanese general who operates under the same code and waterboards an American flyer, how would you judge him morally or legally? You,
that is not the current circumstance with Al Qaeda.
Now, I'm asking you, what would you do? You said anything goes in terms of defending this country. That's pure nationalism. I accept it. I'm close to you on that, except I think there are limits. I'm just asking if you have any.
I don't have any limits relative to Al Qaeda. None. Blowtorch. Okay, Christopher wants to reference a blowtorch. It's fine. Any example you want to come up with Al Qaeda, I'll go along with.
Well, there you are. You see, there are three things. One is, point very well made by Senator McCain, the torture victim himself. What becomes of our prisoners if we say that anything goes? That's a self-interested point as well as a principled one.
Do you think we're protected by that code when Al-Qaeda grabs
really
one of our people?
So. I mean, I think it could now be increasingly unpleasant to be an American POW, and you can see the justification they'd come up with. I thought McCain was right to point that out.
Second, you think the killers of Richard Pearl needed any justification for cutting his head off?
Daniel Pearl,
do you think they had to read the papers to get, cut his head off because look what the Americans are doing in Abu Ghraib?
I agree they don't need an incentive to behave as vilely as they do. I wouldn't allow them that excuse, but once the United States has said anything goes to a prisoner of ours, you can see that it could make life uncomfortable for an American prisoner.
Concerned about the fate of Richard Pearl as Daniel Pearl.
Yeah, of course, so would I. Absolutely, let's agree on that. And then the second point, obvious, is that those of us who've criticized this are saying it opens the door to rougher stuff, pincers, blowtorch.
My antagonist has just simply said,
yes, that's absolutely
the
right.
The reason for the Geneva Accords, of course, you know this, Michael Swartz, I'm not teaching you, I'm not patronizing you, all this was so that we would have some sense of equality of treatment of prisoners. That's why there were Geneva Accords, not because they're humanitarian, but because they were hoping that there could be a deal that once you're captured and safely in custody, there's no reason to torture you, even for intelligence reasons.
Chris, David Ben-Gurion.
That's why we have Geneva Conventions.
David Ben-Gurion said it far better than I will do justice right now about how it's wonderful to philosophize about a utopian society. I would just like to be around to enjoy it. And that's the issue. And the two of you are presupposing that what we do will dictate the path taken by Al-Qaeda. On September 11, they showed they're not playing by any set of rules but their own. And so whatever extraordinary measures are necessary, I couldn't be more clear. I might be wrong, but I couldn't be more clear in my view. Do it.
All right, in fairness to my opponent and also to the Vice President, the Khalid Sheikh Mohammed case may be the closest we ever get to the famous ticking bomb instance. I mean, that might be the nearest we got. We know this guy knows a hell of a lot. We know we're in something of a hurry. We could be impeached. After all, the 9/11 Commission, celebrated by all, accepts testimony that was extorted by torture.
Okay, let me ask you.
If we forgave the people who did a shortcut that time, we said, all right, that one time, that one guy, maybe. But the difficulty is when emergency measures, as with wiretapping, become routine.
Okay, let me ask you about the emergency measures. I want to know where you stand on the Dershowitz. Howard Dershowitz is a famous civil libertarian lawyer, a liberal in many regards, but in the case of terrorism, he says when you have a ticking bomb situation, in other words, you picked up somebody, an advanced team, part of a terrorist operation, you got them a day ahead, an hour ahead, there's something big coming. What are your rules then?
Well, you'll never get that case. The KSM case isn't that case, either.
No, but when you have something coming.
To borrow a phrase.
How about the 20th? How about the hijacker we had out here in Minnesota that was picked up, was trying to get flight lessons? Wouldn't it have been useful to get some information from him?
Well, it would have been useful to look at his computer.
Yeah.
But the our brilliant FBI and CIA couldn't coordinate on that point.
Right. Well, let me ask you the philosophical question. Are you against the ticking bomb torture? Where somebody has something that's vital to stopping a Holocaust-type situation of thousands getting killed. Would you torture that person?
The more seductive the excuse, the more I'm opposed to it. The more tempting the alibi, the more I think it needs to be examined. Because what people are asking for is one excuse to allow for a general imposition of a policy that would be illegal under any law.
Lines, Michael, where do you draw the line? You say for Al-Qaeda, what other groups? Hamas? Any terrorist, the IRA, the Basque terrorists? I mean, where do you draw the line on using torture to get information from terrorists?
The Which views groups? That I've articulated are really limited to Al-Qaeda in the present context. And by the way, I've spoken with Professor Dershowitz about this extensively, and I think he would argue that the Israelis were confronted with a ticking time bomb case at Yom Kippur 2007. He's written about it fairly extensively. But my comments are limited to Al-Qaeda in the present sense.
How did they rule in the Israeli case?
What we don't know, Chris, is what means were utilized to get the information, but they got the information and they were successful in thwarting an attack.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. Michael Smerconish, Christopher Hitchens.